वे फॉरवर्ड इज तुहाडा बहुत बहुत स्वागत है। मैं तुहाडा होस्ट हरजोत सिंह। पिछले हफ्ते असी गल शुरू की सी यूएस विच स्लेवरी की। असी गल शुरू की सी एक यूएस हिस्टोरियन सरदार जयदीप सिंह जी नाल, जो कि कैलिफोर्निया स्टेट यूनिवर्सिटी विच फॉर्मली एक लैक्चरर रहे। वो रेस नूं और रिलीजन नूं मॉडर्न पॉलिटिक्स दे विज़ावेज पढ़ते हैं, समझते हैं, एक एक्टिविस्ट भी हैं। अज असी फिर उन्होंने इनवाइट किया है। जयदीप जी, तुहाडा बहुत बहुत स्वागत है।
सत श्री अकाल जी, थैंक यू फॉर इनवाइटिंग मी बैक, इट्स अ प्लेजर टू बी हियर।
जयदीप जी, पिछली बार तुसी सानू स्लेवरी दी बैकग्राउंड दसी, इस कंट्री विच स्लेवरी दी हिस्ट्री दसी, और आपां गल कीती कुछ रेसिज़म दी। तुसी ए सानू दसिया कि किवें जो रेस है वो एक बायोलॉजिकल फैक्ट नहीं है, बल्कि एक सोशल कंस्ट्रक्ट है, एक पॉलिटिकल वेपन है स्लेवरी जैसी चीज़ नू कामयाब करन लई। अज असी तुहाडे तो कुछ बेसिक क्वेश्चंस पहले पूछना चाहांगे, फिर असी जेड़ा स्लेवरी दे बाद जो इस कंट्री विच होया है उसके बारे गल करांगे। एक क्लैरिफिकेशन जो कुछ साडे व्यूअर्स ने साडे तो मंगी है, वो पूछ रहे सीगे कि ये जेड़े स्लेव्स यूएस विच लियाए जांदे सीगे फ्रॉम अफ्रीका, एक किवें लियाए जाते सीगे? वॉज इट अ रिजल्ट ऑफ एनी वॉर, या उन्होंने उत्थे खरीदया जांदा सी, बेचदा कौन सी? How were they stolen and how were they brought here?
Well, you know, slavery is something that's almost as old as human history. It goes across many cultures, many, you know, across time and space in many different places. But the thing is, and this is also true in Africa, generally slaves were people who were captured in combat. And that is how slavery was in Africa. Mm-hmm. The difference with European slavery, the African slave trade, was that they designated an entire continent of people who were defined and marked by their race as a permanent slave class for the building of Europe and of North America. So there was nothing racial about slavery in Africa, in Arabia, in parts of Europe historically. Gee. But what you did have is slavery was a punishment for generally, you know, captured prisoners of war. Hmm. But what America did was something entirely different. They specified a specific group of slaves, brought them halfway around the world, and used it to build the richest country in the world. And it was a racial institution marked by race, unlike anywhere else in the world.
So, jada fir race da element hai, that is what's different, because it jada, as you said, slavery ta historically hamesha rahi hai. You know, when Arabs used to have slaves, they had Arabs as slaves as well. They would have black slaves as well, but oh, ladai karde si aapas se jo prisoners of wars honde si ge, unanu vi slave rakhya gaya, you know, from time to time. Eastern slave trade and jada Atlantic slave trade hai, is there which jada difference hai, you identify the element of race to be the difference? Is that fair to say?
Absolutely. And also, you've never had this type of importation, bringing slaves halfway around the world. Hmm. Very specifically taken to very specific places to do very specific things. What you had was almost like random slaves who were people, you know, people who were enslaved. But the African slave trade was very specific. And as I mentioned last week, they would choose Africans from specific areas for very specific skills they had: farming skills, weaving skills, carpentry skills. These are things they brought with them from Africa, from their great civilizations, and that Americans used to build their country and make them rich.
So would they pay somebody to get these slaves, or how would they get their hands on these slaves?
Absolutely. Yeah, no, the slave trade was incredibly lucrative and made many, many, many men very, very wealthy. That was without people, you know, without the slave traders going to Africa to get the slaves, there would be no slave trade. There would be no slavery. And so those people were extremely important. And they were some of the worst human beings that you can imagine. The way they convinced other Africans to sell their brothers and sisters into slavery. Because this wouldn't have happened if the whites hadn't been in Africa offering them all sorts of inducements, money, trinkets, and strange things. I mean, they would give African elites, African kings, wool wool is not something you generally need in a semi-tropical area, but these African kings wanted this wool because it was a sign of status, that they were great, like the so-called European, you know, the so-called great Europeans. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, it's really, really some horrible aspects of the slave trade.
But you cannot deny that there's some shame on part of those Africans as well who were selling their own brethren into slavery.
Undoubtedly.
Isn't that fair
Absolutely.
To say?
Absolutely. But any human being that does that to anybody, regardless of it's your brother or your race, I mean, that's barbarism. It's barbarity. And of course, but again, the point is they wouldn't have done this if people weren't paying them to do it. It was the idea of the white man who came to Africa with the intent of taking people to make money.
Jaideep ji, asi last week gal shuru kiti si ki how these elites have benefited and how you say the whole modern economy is based on slavery. Jehda average banda hai in places like US, did they benefit? Or ek narrative hai ga ki it was bad for them because of wages nu low kar reha siga. So can you tell us what's the truth behind that?
That's a great point. So, as I mentioned last week, slavery of Africans, it laid the foundation for the modern world economic system, for modern capitalism. The massive infrastructure that was required to move 10 million Africans halfway around the world, it built entire cities in Europe.
Can I ask you something? There's just one point I missed. Jehda tusi eh gal keh rahe ho ki jehdi modern cities African slaves ne banaiyan. So, if I ask you, agar assi old cities di vi gal kariye jive pyramids sige, oh slaves ne banaye sige, vadi Taj Mahal in a way slaves ne banaya. So what's the difference? It has always been like that in human civilizations, right?
There's a difference between a slave, a slave society that's run by a monarch, like a pharaoh or a king. But we are supposed to be the greatest, most progressive, multiracial, progressive Republican democracy on the planet. And in that country, which proclaims in its founding democracy that all men are created equal, in its founding documents that all men are created equal, other people aren't professing to have these great ideals, but America does. And other people aren't pretending to be democratic, in which the power is invested in the people. In these societies that built the pyramids, it was invested generally in one man or one family. And so it's a very different reality, historical as well as contemporary.
No, that's a very profound point. So going back, how did an average man benefit from the slavery?
Okay, so as I mentioned, all these cities were built. I mean, London itself, it emerged as a global center of commerce only because of slavery. Only because of slavery. And the same thing for New York. It emerged as a global center of finance because of slavery. The international financial and distribution networks that were required to coordinate, maintain, and profit from slavery, they set up the framework for the next 100, I guess it's been 100, almost 200 years now, for the modern global economy, because slavery launched modern capitalism. And as I mentioned, it suddenly made America the most wealthy nation in the world. Well, how did that wealth manifest? Now, what I was unable to talk about last week was how all sections of white settler society were to a large extent dependent upon African slave labor for their survival and their success. Now, it's true, only 25% of the population in the colonial times, right, when it was under colonial British, owned slaves. However, slavery factored heavily in the economy for all of the British North American colonies. It wasn't just the plantation economy in the South. Everyone benefited from exploiting enslaved blacks. Let me give some examples. The fishermen, whose low-grade refuse fish was dried and sold as slave meal to the Indies. They couldn't sell those fish to white folks, so the ones that they would have had to throw away, they sold to slaves. The New York farmer who found a market for his extra goods in the southern plantations. The forester whose timber was used by shipyard workers who were turning out slave ships. The clerk in New York City in the export house who checked bales of tobacco awaiting shipment to London. The master cooper in the Boston Rum Distillery. A cooper is someone who makes those, those giant barrels that you people in New York go over Niagara Falls in. So, that's what a cooper does. And the immigrant German farmer who rented a team of five slaves to get his farm started, and on and on and on. Now, of course, the majority of the profits went to the big planters, right? The big slave owners and the merchant capitalists, the big guys. However, the entire settler economy, and by settler, I mean these people who came to this nation and settled permanently, this settler economy was raised up on the foundation of slave labor, slave products, and the slave trade itself. I mean, even our first president, George Washington, was deeply dependent on slavery to maintain his conquest lifestyle of splendor. Although we don't really have time to discuss it in detail. I'll just say that he inherited 10 slaves from his father at age of 11. And he continued to acquire slaves his whole life,
Jaideep ji, we'll take a short break here. द वे फॉरवर्ड तुहाडा फिर तो स्वागत है, मैं तुहाडा होस्ट हरजोत सिंह। जयदीप जी, ब्रेक ते जाण तों पहलां तुसी अपनी गल कंप्लीट करो, देन वी गो टू द नेक्स्ट क्वेश्चन प्लीज।
या आई वाज टॉकिंग अबाउट जॉर्ज वॉशिंगटन। बेसिकली ही वाज अ स्लेव ओनर टू द कोर। ही सपोर्टेड पॉलिटिकल पॉलिसीज दैट वुड प्रोटेक्ट स्लेव ओनर्स हु इन्वेस्टेड मनी इन ब्लैक बॉडीज। फॉर एग्जांपल, इन 1793 वॉशिंगटन साइंड द फर्स्ट फ्यूजिटिव स्लेव लॉ। This allowed fugitive slaves to be seized in any state, tried, and returned to their owner. Now, we were complaining about President Trump because he had all these conflicts of interest, right, and things that he did. He personally made money off of very many things that he did. This is an example of how our first president benefited financially from this law, much like the corrupt man we just threw out of office.
जयदीप जी, आई थिंक वी शुड थ्रो लाइट ऑन ऑल दीज आस्पेक्ट्स एज वेल। एंड यू नो, ये चीज़ें नवी नवी डिस्कवर होंगी। यूनिवर्सिटी ऑफ पेंसिल्वेनिया, उन्होंने विल्सन के नाम से जो स्कूल सेगा, दे हैव चेंज, वी कीप ऑन प्रोग्रेसिंग, बट वी शुडंट फॉरगेट। आई डोंट नो इफ वी शुड फॉरगेट और हाउ शुड वी हैंडल दीज फैक्ट्स कि हिस्टोरिकली स्लेवरी एक फैक्ट रहा है। इस्लाम विच, शरिया विच जिहड़ी स्लेवरी है, हली भी इट्स नॉट इलीगल, इट्स स्टिल लीगल। एंड कई प्रोफिट्स वास्ते कहते हैं कि यू नो, बॉट एंड सोल्ड स्लेव्स। सो आई डोंट नो हाउ डू वी व्यू दोज थिंग्स, बट डेफिनेटली इन दिस कंट्री एंड इन द कॉन्टेक्स्ट यू सेड दैट व्हेन वी क्लेम ऑल मेन आर क्रिएटेड इक्वल, यू नो, काफ़ी ऑक्सीमोरोनिक और हिपोक्रिटिकल हो जाता है। बट असी, यू नो, आई वुड जस्ट लेट यू फिनिश योर थॉट, एंड न्यूयॉर्क सिटी नू लैके तुसी कुछ कहना चाहते सीगे, एंड देन विल गो टू टू यू नो द पीरियड आफ्टर द वॉर, what happened after that, but tushi please finish your thought.
I think New York is really a perfect example to really understand the effect of slavery and how many people who weren't directly involved in actually beating slaves or overworking them, how they benefited. Now, the more one studies slavery, the more it becomes very apparent that as the slavery of business went, so did all businesses in this country. It was central to the entire nation's economic development. New York's a very good example. Mm-hmm. New York profited immensely from the commerce in black bodies. As I mentioned last week, for every dollar generated by cotton, in the 1850s, cotton was one half of the U.S. economy. Okay, so it's there's nothing even close to it. So for every dollar generated by cotton, 40% of it ended up in New York City, which supplied shipping, insurance, and financing. Northern financiers were deeply implicated in this Southern enterprise, Wall Street. Right, I mean, it's almost in many ways the defining institution of New York City and American capitalism. Right, it's the heart of American capitalism. After 9/11, remember, that was the most important thing they had to open was the stock market. So Wall Street, how did it become important? It became a vital capitalist financial center because it was the first big slave trade center in the colonies, and later the new nation's principal slave trading port. Wall Street firms made fortunes from financing the slave trade. Merchants became wealthy from the transport and sale of slave-produced goods. Others bankrolled southern plantations, insured slaves as property, and used slaves as collateral for loans. Investment in slavery was one of the most profitable economic activities through most of New York's 350-year history. Much of the financing, I'll give you some examples of some names that you know. Much of the financing for the slave economy flowed through New York banks. Corporations like Aetna, J.P. Morgan, New York Life all profited from slavery. Lehman Brothers, one of Wall Street's largest firms until 2008, got its start in the slave economy of Alabama. Mm-hmm. Brooks Brothers just went out of business, I think. They used to supply clothing to plantation owners for their slaves. Not the stuff you and I can get when we go to the store for, you know, wear with our suits, mm-hmm. but the most rough-hewn, ugly, you know, refuse clothes, and they sold it to slaves.
Gee.
So bankers, merchants, manufacturers, average citizens, everyone profited from exploiting enslaved Africans. Gee. All, and this is, I think, the really a key point here. All white Americans were indirectly enriched by slavery because the free labor provided by blacks, by enslaved blacks, was the primary factor that enabled the U.S. to become the economic powerhouse it did in a short time. Why do people migrate here from India? It's about the economic power of this country, right?
Gee.
Well, where did that economic power come from? How do they shoot ahead of everybody? Slavery. So, as I mentioned, slave-produced cotton was central to the U.S.'s early economic expansion because it was a huge portion of our entire GDP. So it wasn't hard. It wasn't the hard work of white Americans that propelled the U.S. to economic independence, but the unfree labor of blacks. Now, New York City dominated the cotton trade, right? So half of all total exports in 1850 was cotton. This is a creation of slavery. Slavery was so intertwined with the economy of New York City that New York, at the time of the Civil War, was one of the most pro-slavery municipalities in the entire North. They were getting rich. In fact, as the Civil War approached, the mayor of New York City proposed to secede. New York City would have seceded with the South. How many people in New York know that? The mayor did not want to stay with the Union because he was afraid that slavery would end and they would lose all that lucrative cotton trade with the South. Now, this story is amazing because it illustrates the incredibly deep involvement of New York City in the slave trade. I'll give you one last example. Now, I know in the last couple of years, on the Domino Factory, the sugar factory in Brooklyn, it's gotten a lot of publicity because they remade it from a sugar factory into gentrified condos. Well, it actually it made its mark and its money by refining sugarcane and molasses that was produced by slaves in the Caribbean. So, I mean, and the other point I should make before we move on, is Africans were pioneer Wall Streeters. Their labor built much of the city's actual infrastructure. They built the city. They did the heavy work. They cleared the land. They built the port. They widened American Indian trails that created roads. These included the first city hall, built by slaves, stretches of Broadway, and the signature wall that defined Wall Street, and all built by slaves.
Important thing is not just physical labor. They provided the skilled labor. Isn't that right?
Absolutely. Absolutely. And I think that really is the key of racism. We are so infected with racism that we believe that Africans weren't talented and brilliant and skilled. Racism worked really well in us that we have those ideas. That's the whole point of racism, is to overthrow what you see in front of you with lies. And unfortunately, it's worked very well even for people like us who've migrated to this country in the last 20, 30, 40, 50 years.
Jaideep ji, Tusi, you have laid down very well what was the situation like under slavery, how this country benefited, how it was built on the backs of these Africans who were brought here as slaves. Now, there's a development in human history, in this country's history. There's a war and, slavery ends. Now, ਸਾਡੀ ਜਿਹੜੀ particularly ਸਾਡੀ community 'ਚ ਵੇਖਿਆ ਗਿਆ ਜਦੋਂ ਅਸੀਂ ਗੱਲ ਕਰਦੇ ਹਾਂ ਉਹ ਕਹਿੰਦੇ ਬਈ 1865 ਵਿੱਚ ਸਲੇਵਰੀ ਖਤਮ ਹੋ ਗਈ ਦ ਬਲੈਕ ਪੀਪਲ ਨੀਡ ਟੂ ਫੋਰਗੇਟ ਦੈਟ ਐਂਡ ਆਫਟਰ ਦੈਟ ਐਵਰੀਥਿੰਗ ਹੈਜ਼ ਬੀਨ ਰੋਜ਼ੀ ਫੋਰ ਦੈਮ ਜਸਟ ਐਜ਼ ਫੋਰ ਐਨੀ ਅਦਰ ਵਾਈਟ ਮੈਨ ਔਨ ਦ ਸਟਰੀਟ ਇਜ਼ ਦੈਟ ਰਾਈਟ ਕੈਨ ਯੂ ਪਲੀਜ਼ ਟੈਲ ਅਸ ਵਾਟ ਹੈਪਨਡ ਵਿਦ ਦ ਬਲੈਕਸ ਆਫਟਰ ਦ ਵਾਰ ਵਾਜ਼ ਓਵਰ
So people who believe that are essentially victims of one of the greatest conspiracies in American history. So when we look at the immediate aftermath of the war, just as the slaves were getting their first taste of freedom, they were betrayed. Just as they were free, they were getting sick and dying by the thousands, the tens of thousands. So it's one of the bitterest ironies in U.S. history. After 1619 to 1865, they were enslaved. And then suddenly they become free. And let me give you an example.
And what was the reason for that? What was the reason for that sickness?
I'll tell you in just one second. But let me just give you a number so it quantifies this. One scholar who's scoured obscured records, the scholar has found that a quarter of the 4 million freed slaves either died or suffered from illness between 1862 and 1870. So that's one out of four. So that's essentially genocide. The indifference with which former slaves were treated by the newly united nation at the end of the war produced the largest biological crisis of the 19th century. Mm-hmm. Freed slaves were neglected by Union soldiers, or they faced rampant disease, including horrific outbreaks of smallpox and cholera. The smallpox epidemic was worsened by lack of medical care, malnutrition, extreme poverty, and horrible living conditions. Just as all these African Americans finally got the freedom they'd fought and risked their lives for. Finally, as they achieved that, many Africans simply starved to death. A horrific, slow death.
So Jaideep ji, ye jehdi bimari hai, is the jo wajah hai, you know, you say so many of them perished. Is it because they were not accepted in the mainstream? Is it because they did not have jobs after they left those plantations? Ki sanu thoda hor vistar ch dassoge?
Absolutely. So, I mean, the reason this happened is because most Northerners were a little more sympathetic than Southerners when it came to the health of these freed slaves. They didn't care. And that's just the reality of American life. You can see it when, you know, George Floyd is killed. Mm-hmm. You can see it when, you know, the gentleman who was murdered in, I think, Staten Island said, "I couldn't breathe." I mean, we see it today. This complete indifference to black life in white America. That's kind of the, if you look at American history, that's really one of the defining characteristics of whiteness in American society, is not only a complete disregard for the lives and health of people of color. And we've seen that with the epidemic. Look at the numbers. You may not want to say it, but look at the numbers. The numbers are damning. So instead of working for the welfare of those who'd been legally been property their entire lives, these abolitionists, the people who wanted to destroy slavery, when they saw so many freed people dying, instead they worried that it proved true what racists said, that blacks were not able to survive.
Jaideep ji, assi eh gal jari rakhange, ik choti ji break de baad, tusi vekhde raho, The Way Forward. द वे फॉरवर्ड इज थोड़ा फिर तो स्वागत है मैं थोड़ा होस्ट हरजोत सिंह अज असी गल कर रहे हैं हिस्टोरियन जयदीप सिंह जी नाल यूएस विच स्लेवरी दी हिस्ट्री नू लाके जयदीप जी सो बिफोर गोइंग टू द ब्रेक यू वर टेलिंग अस अबाउट दिस इलनेस दैट बिफेल ऑन द यू नो रिसेंटली फ्रीड ब्लैक पीपल इन दिस कंट्री कैन यू टेल अस मोर
एब्सोल्युटली So basically, they didn't get any help from the Northerners.
Gee.
So many freed people ended up living in encampments, basically refugee camps that were called contraband camps.
Gee.
If you know anything about refugee camps in this world, in Palestine, in Thailand, in all these various places, the mortality is extremely high. People lose eyes like nothing. You know, they lose a leg. That's just the reality. So 4 million slaves were essentially tossed into these outdoor camps, and the conditions in these temporary shelters were insanitary. And food supplies limited. So of course there was illness.
Gee.
Shockingly, some contraband camps were actually former slave pens.
Gee.
So those forced newly freed families into being kept virtual prisoners in the same cells that had previously held them in bondage. In these camps, disease and hunger led to countless deaths. Often the only way to leave a camp was to agree to go back to work on the same plantation from which the slave had just recently escaped. Now, even the Union soldiers, right? The saviors.
I would ask you something here. You know, we sometimes hear that it was by design that a system was created that although these people were freed, a system was created that where they had no choice other than returning to those plantations and work at minimal wages, if not free. Is that right?
Actually, they didn't even get wages. What they were pushed into for that next century until the 60s was sharecropping. So essentially, they don't own anything. The master owns the land, they work the land, and they have to give a huge portion of their harvest to the master. So with whatever is left, they have to try to survive, and often it wasn't enough. Basically, what ended up happening is people got into debt and more debt and more debt. And so you'd work 20 years and you owed more money than at the beginning. Sharecropping was a system designed to keep blacks and their families and their future generations in permanent bondage to white people. Mm-hmm. So we'll talk more about slave I'm sorry, sharecropping when we talk about the Jim Crow era, but that was the defining labor for black men in particular during that time, in black families, because the entire family would pick.
Jaydeep ji, I'm sorry, go ahead.
Well, I wanted to make one last point about Union soldiers. The Union soldiers were the saviors, right? The North, well, they were often very brutal because they were also still very racist. Consider the experiences of one freed slave. His name was Joseph Miller. He had come with his wife and four children to a makeshift freed slave camp within the Union stronghold of Camp Nelson in Kentucky. In return for food and shelter for his family, Miller joined the army. Yet Union soldiers still cleared the ex-slaves out of Camp Nelson in 1864, basically abandoning them to scavenge in a war-ravaged and disease-ridden landscape. They kicked them out. They kicked them out into a land that had just experienced a horrifying civil war. Here's what happened to him and his family. One of Miller's sons quickly got sick and died. 3 weeks later, his wife and a second son died. 10 days after that, his daughter perished. Finally, his last child fell terminally ill. And by 1965, just a year later, in this outdoor camp, Miller himself was dead.
JDB, there are instances where, you know, we have seen these Union soldiers or, you know, the so-called elitists of the society at that time, worrying that these black freed slaves, particularly those who served in the army, are now trained. They have arms. They'll become dangerous. They'll become a threat to the society. And, you know, all means were adopted to keep them, you know, under the leash. At the same time, the black man who was recently freed, I would like to know from you, how did they view this recently acquired freedom for themselves?
Well, it's something they've been fighting for 200 years, 250 years. So African-Americans' unceasing efforts to secure economic, political, and family rights made them central players in the post-Civil War drama. The ex-slaves expressed their newfound freedom, as limited as it actually was, in a number of ways. It shows us how important it was for African-Americans to start to build communities and culture and to better themselves, because they realized that whites weren't going to help them. For some, it was as specific and personal as the decision to just take a new name. Because for many slaves, the last name came from the slave master who may have raped your mother. So as fundamental, it could have been as, you know, others, as fundamental as uniting your entire family in a single household, because slaves were often sold off. Sometimes as punishment, they would sell a man's wife off if he tried to run away. Freedom was dressing as one pleased. They couldn't do that before. Perhaps wearing a colorful shirt or hat. I mean, this is important, especially for Punjabi. Think about if you try to tell a Punjabi you can't wear, you know, bright colors. We're the most colorful people in the world. So a colorful shirt or a hat, but it was also refusing to be deferential to one's former owner. Because previously, if a white person's walking down the street and you didn't step out of the way, they'd kill you. All right, so you don't have to show deference and, you know, be subservient to whites in public anymore. So soon after the Confederacy's final defeat, freed people in Richmond, Virginia, for example, began to hold meetings without securing white permission. That's something they couldn't do before because they were afraid of slave rebellions. They walked in Capitol Square, an area previously restricted to white residents only, refusing to yield the sidewalks to approaching white men and women. Had they displayed such temerity during slavery, they could have been beaten, jailed, or killed. Freedom also meant that thousands of freed slaves could travel and search for loved ones who had been sold away during the war. Emancipation enabled these and other blacks to formalize long-standing relationships, officially registering their marriages.
Jaydeep ji, another important element which I'd like to bring out. You know, they talk of personal responsibility in this country, and bada kya janda ki these, you know, sometimes ki the African American community, they don't make those efforts to improve their lives. You know, one of the first things they did after they got free was to create schools for their kids where blacks were employed as teachers. Isn't that right?
The first years after emancipation saw a tremendous upsurge in African-American demands for education and control over their churches. They understood what it would take for them to move forward in this racist country. Freed people built schools. They hired black teachers. They also challenged white domination of biracial congregations and founded their own churches. such as the African Methodist Episcopal Church. And you can find this in every big city in America. These independent churches became the moral and cultural center of Black life, and their preachers emerged as community leaders, along with school teachers and ex-soldiers. The churches often hosted Black political meetings, including dozens of rallies where freedmen raised demands for full civil equality. Now, this goes right from the beginning of the Civil War to 100 years later in the Civil Rights Movement. That's exactly the same place where these strategies were developed, where people were bolstered and people were brought together and moved out to challenge white supremacy by putting their bodies and lives on the line. So the Black church is the most important of Black institutions simply because whites didn't let them have anything else during slavery.
जयदीप जी, दैट्स वेरी इंटरेस्टिंग. और इस टाइम नू असी समझने की कोशिश कर रहे हैं. प्लीज थ्रो अ लिटल लाइट ऑन व्हाइल ऑल दिस वाज हैपनिंग, व्हाट वाज हैपनिंग ऑन द पॉलिटिकल एरिना.
सो एक्चुअली देयर इज वन पॉइंट आई लाइक टू मेक इन टर्म्स ऑफ हाउ देयर फ्रीडम. नाउ द न्यूली फ्रीड ब्लैक्स, दे सॉ एज द की टू रियलाइजिंग इंडिपेंडेंस एंड फ्रीडम एज लैंड ओनरशिप.
जी,
दिस इज समथिंग दे वर प्रॉमिस्ड, एंड दिस इज द ग्रेट बिट्रेयल that has kept Blacks impoverished for, you know, since the Civil War, 160 years now. It was a brilliant conspiracy to keep them impoverished. Now, they knew that they needed land. Said one soldier from this time period, every colored man will be a slave and feel himself a slave until he can raise his own bale of cotton and put his own mark on it and say, this is mine. Now, many believed they were entitled to land in returns for years of unpaid labor, which created the wealth of the cotton kingdoms in the South as well as the North. They knew that without land, they would remain fundamentally subservient to the economic power of their former owners. The future condition of these former slaves was a central question in the Reconstruction period immediately following the Civil War. Would they be given access to land and true freedom?
जयदीप जी, टाइम फॉर अ स्मॉल ब्रेक. तो ना एक गल जारी रखेंगे एक छोटी जी ब्रेक के बाद. देखते रहो द वे फॉरवर्ड. द वे फॉरवर्ड इज तुहाडा फिर तो स्वागत है. मैं तुहाडा होस्ट हरजोत सिंह. जयदीप जी, ब्रेक ते जाण तो पहला तुसीं सानूं दस रहे सी कि किवें बाय डिज़ाइन जिहड़े अफ्रीकन अमेरिकन सन उन्हां नूं डिप्राइव किया गया लैंड ओनरशिप तो, क्योंकि उन्हां तो वो पावर जिहड़ी है वह दूर रखने लई. सानूं प्लीज़ दस सकदे हो इस बारे होर.
श्योर, एब्सोल्युटली. वेल, यू नो, आई थिंक इवन व्हेन यू लुक, सो वी आर टॉकिंग अबाउट अ पीरियड ऑफ फ्रीडम इन व्हिच ब्लैक्स आर सडनली गिवन ऑल दीज़ राइट्स दैट दे हैव बीन डिप्राइव्ड ऑफ फॉर सो लॉन्ग. एंड एज़ यू कैन इमेजिन, व्हाइट पीपल वर एक्सट्रीमली अपसेट. I mean, if you look at the assault that happened on in the U.S. Capitol, that was very much a white supremacist aggression. If you look at the people who were there, they're 99% white, pretty much like the people who voted for Trump. So if they're like that now, what do you think they were like 160 years ago? They were incredibly vicious in trying to keep black people under their foot. So during the first year of freedom, countless incidents of violence were directed against freed slaves simply for expressing their freedom and independence. Plantation owners especially opposed the efforts of black Southerners to get land for themselves to farm. Planters and freed people both understood that black land ownership would destroy white control of labor in the South and would lead to the collapse of the plantation economy. So they had to destroy anyone who offered an example of such independence. If even a few independent black farmers succeeded, concluded one Mississippi planter, quote, all the others will be dissatisfied with their wages, no matter how good they may be. And thus our whole labor system is bound to be upset. So to maintain control, the planters looked to their state governments. The struggle over the meaning and extent of freedom for black people shifted into the political arena.
So what laws, what, you know, political means they used to keep them under the suppression?
Absolutely. So as has always been the case, black Americans after the Civil War were betrayed by powerful white men in Washington, D.C. But the power structure had to first deal with the potential of black anger exploding. Remember, we're talking about millions of angry former slaves. Now, but before I get into the political arena, we have to understand how blacks were driving the politics of the day. With their demands for land and justice. They were absolutely the central political actors in this country for really the first time in American history. Hmm. Now, the South's defeat in 1965, it settled two major debates. The nation was preserved and slavery was dead because the war was about slavery. That's it. That's it. You're going to hear a lot of lies by white supremacists to the other, you know, that say something else. But the war was really about only one thing, slavery. Now, those two things were settled, but everything else was in doubt. Who would hold economic and political power in the South in the aftermath of the war? How would the land be worked? And how would labor be organized? What would freedom mean for the 4 million former slaves? Now, the answers to these momentous questions would define the era known as Reconstruction, during which the country was rejoined after the Civil War. Now, I want to try to give you, before we get into the politics, let's look at the situation that impelled the politics, that forced these political decisions, okay? Judge John C. Underwood of Richmond, Virginia, testified the following before Congress. He said, "I had a conversation with the leading men in that city, and he said to me that the enlistment of Negro troops by the United States was the turning point of the rebellion, that it was the heaviest blow they ever received. He remarked that when Negroes deserted their masters and showed a gentle disposition to do so and join the forces of the United States, intelligent men everywhere saw that the matter was ended." So the U.S. took advantage of the rising of enslaved Africans to squash the Confederacy. They put them in the army, and that's when the war was essentially over. But now they had a problem on their hands, something you alluded to earlier. Throughout the nation, blacks had seized land that they had formerly sweated and bled on. So occupying Union armies had to watch out not only for the still angry and dangerous Confederates, but they had to ensure that black people did not explode in righteous rage. Now, most perceptive white people understood this issue well. The Boston capitalist Eliezer Wright said in 1865, quote, "The blacks must be enfranchised, that means given the vote, or they will be ready and willing to fight for a government of their own," unquote. Gee. Having broken the back of the Confederacy and having armed and trained themselves, as you mentioned, the black masses were in no mood to passively submit to basically re-enslavement. Okay, it may not have been slavery, but slavery in another form, which I defined earlier as sharecropping, and I'll talk more about that later.
So that means they were given a right to vote, not because they were seen as equal citizens, because there was a design to keep them, to prevent them from raising their, becoming a force, becoming a voice.
You know, all these people who were complaining about the protests that swept our country this summer, they really don't know anything about the history of this country. It is only protest by black people, by Mexicans, by Chinese, by Punjabis over the past 250 years that has forced America to become more democratic, more fair, right? So this is something, if you know anything about U.S. history, this is the reality that those on the outside, on the margins, have pushed the mainstream to expand the rights of all Americans. Hmm. So basically, they demanded land. After creating wealth for white people for 250 years, they wanted land so they could do it. Now, as the great scholar W.E.B. Du Bois explains, again, the most important scholar, I think, of the 20th century, quote, "There was a continual fear of insurrection in the Black Belt." So the Black Belt is that portion of the country, specifically on both sides of the Mississippi River, where black people are an overwhelming majority of the population, even today. Okay, so there was a fear of insurrection in the Black Belt. This vague fear increased towards Christmas, 1866. The Negroes were disappointed because of the delayed division of lands. There was a natural desire to get possession of firearms. And all through the summer and fall, they're acquiring shotguns, muskets, and pistols in great quantities. Gee. General Rufus Saxton, who was the former head of the Freedmen's Bureau, was a government entity that helped the freed men and women to, adjust to life as free people. And they didn't do a great job. But the former head of the Freedmen's Bureau in South Carolina reported to Congress in 1866 that black field workers in that state were arming themselves and refusing to submit quietly to the return of white rule. President Lincoln, this is before the war, President Lincoln wrote to one of his generals, "I can hardly believe the South and North can live in peace unless we get rid of the Negroes." Hmm. Certainly, this is President Lincoln. certainly they cannot, if we don't get rid of the Negroes whom we have armed and disciplined, who have fought with us, I believe, to the amount of 150,000 men. I believe it would be better off to export them all. Send them elsewhere. Now, this is really interesting because approximately 70 years earlier, Thomas Jefferson, the third president, has suggested the exact same thing by sending black people to Africa. He said, we can't set them free. They can't live with us, so send them to Africa. So this is a really interesting theme that keeps recurring among white supremacist presidents. Now, during this time, black soldiers were a special target of the Union and the Confederates alike. The Freedmen's Bureau said in 1866 that the new secret white terrorist organizations in Mississippi, like the Ku Klux Klan, placed a special priority on murdering returning African-American veterans of the Army. Now, not only were these men less likely to bow down to public white supremacy, but black men in uniform obviously disproved white supremacist claims of black inferiority, or they wouldn't be scared of them. Mm-hmm. Moreover, they were trained in the use of firearms, often owning such weapons as well.
Jaideep ji, if you'll allow me, this is very important, and I'm sorry for breaking your chain of thoughts.
No, you haven't done it. I love this.
We have run out of time for today.
You're so much better than my students. They just stand up and raise their hands.
We have to continue this. We will request you to make time for us next week as well. We will do this in continuation. ਅੱਜ ਅਸੀਂ ਜੈਦੀਪ ਜੀ ਤੋਂ ਇਜਾਜ਼ਤ ਲੈਂਦੇ ਹਾਂ। ਜੈਦੀਪ ਜੀ, ਅੱਜ ਸਾਡੇ ਨਾਲ ਇੱਥੇ ਹਾਜ਼ਰ ਹੋਣ ਵਾਸਤੇ ਤੁਹਾਡਾ ਬਹੁਤ ਬਹੁਤ ਸ਼ੁਕਰੀਆ। ਇਹ ਇੰਪੋਰਟੈਂਟ ਹਿਸਟਰੀ ਦੱਸਣ ਵਾਸਤੇ ਬਹੁਤ ਬਹੁਤ ਸ਼ੁਕਰੀਆ। ਅਸੀਂ ਤੁਹਾਡੇ ਨਾਲ ਇਹ ਗੱਲ ਜਾਰੀ ਰੱਖਾਂਗੇ ਅਗਲੇ ਹਫ਼ਤੇ। ਤੁਸੀਂ ਵੇਖਦੇ ਰਹੋ ਦ ਵੇ ਫੋਰਵਰਡ।